Hi, it's Margaret Crenshaw with the Prudhomme team at Carolina Realty Group, and we're back this week talking real estate stuff, again with Alan Perry of Mortgage Network.
Thanks, Margaret. Glad to be here again.
Thanks for joining us again. And we had so much feedback from the interview we did a couple of weeks back that I've asked you to come back today so that we could dig a little deeper.
Absolutely. Glad I could help.
Okay, good. As realtors, we always stress the importance of using a local lender. And we talked about that a couple weeks back. But can you just describe in a little more detail, I guess, what's the importance of using the local lender?
You know, I've thought about this since the last time we did this. And one of the things is that we specialize. We specialize in this market. So as a doctor specializes in a field, we specialize in Hilton Head. And that gives us the knowledge of the different aspects that go on and the connections with the insurance people, the property management companies, the attorneys, and everybody. So we've got that little extra knowledge about the community and the different nuances that we have.
That's exactly right. And I think that from the realtor perspective, that the transaction is smoother all around because you are the local lender who knows the local insurance people, who knows the local property management, and it just makes for a much smoother transaction.
And we know the local market.
And you know the local market.
That's right.
When is it important for a buyer to reach out to you?
You know, ideally, we'd love for them to reach out the second they decide to buy a new home, but we know that's not realistic. So we kind of rely upon, you know, the realtors as you get a new client, say, you know, what is it that you can afford? You know, where is your buying power? What are you looking to do? And at that point in time, they really need to reach out, you know, to us and say, this is what we're thinking about doing. What can we afford? And in today's world, there are a lot of nuances of how we can utilize income, how we can utilize assets. And, you know, they may not exactly know what their buying power is.
Good point. And I think from the realtor standpoint, in the market right now, you know, it used to be that we would have a few days to get a pre-qualification letter in. In today's market with multiple offers, we see that if our buyer doesn't yet have their pre-qualification at the time that we put the offer in, that sometimes that doesn't strengthen the offer enough that somebody
right.
else is going to get that property instead.
That's right. And as you know, I mean, there have been times that we've had to turn them quickly, which we're happy to do, but it doesn't give us the full insight of the power of the borrower and their, you know, we haven't put the whole puzzle together yet. You know, we get the application online, we take a look, and then we go back to them and ask them for documents. But the more they know up front and are prepared to talk to us, the better everybody is.
Which brings me to my next point. And I know you and I have done a few transactions
this year,
and we've been very successful, particularly when you had the time ahead of my client identifying the property, you had time to go ahead and actually get the pre-approval.
Right.
Not just the pre-qualification letter, but the pre-approval. And
right.
I swear that put us ahead of the competitors.
It makes a difference because, again, the more information that I have in front of me, the better I can understand everything and the cleaner the approval or pre-qualification, you know, the letter that comes out is stronger at that point in time because I can really stand behind it. And because I know I've got that experience, you know, of what to look for, you know, within the scenarios of every buyer and determine the financing.
Exactly. So again, because it's a different market than it was a year and a half, 2 years ago, I mean, it's just, it's really important. I think that buyers think, oh yeah, I'll make that phone call. But it's really honestly the first phone call that needs to be made. It can be made before you've even identified your realtor.
That's correct.
Honestly.
It's true.
I mean, it really could. And before you get in the car with your realtor. Because I tell you, if I know at the end of the day that we've identified a property that we're going to put an offer in on, and they haven't even had the first conversation with the lender, I already feel like I'm behind.
That's correct.
And that's this market. That's the market we're in. Also, the other thing that you and I have come across a few times this year is we have powerful buyers that have cash right now.
Mm-hmm.
They have cash to spend, and cash offers are
king.
They're king. But people are opting to do a combination, put down a lot of cash
right.
up to 50% and finance the rest. Can you
comment
on that scenario?
Well, you know, rates are still great. We're not at the all-time lows, but rates are still great and the return on money right now is still very strong. I'm not a financial planner, but I know that the average return is 6 to 8 to 9% on people's money. So why not leverage the cash that you have and borrow, use some of the money, put it down, but then borrow some and keep the rest in your account and make additional money off of it.
Right. And then at that point, you can capitalize on the
lower
the tax cut. Mm-hmm. And then also, as in terms of the loan process, you get to the point where you come to the appraisal. Explain to everybody what happens at that point.
So the appraisal more is along the lines, you know, with the lower loan to value, there's sometimes, and we don't know when it's going to happen, but with the Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac loans, sometimes there are property inspection waivers that are issued, meaning we don't have to have an appraisal. Now, sometimes people will still have the appraisal because they want to know the true market value from that standpoint of a third party. But sometimes it's not required. And that's a money savings. It's a time savings. And it takes a lot of questions out of the whole transaction. And it speeds things up a little bit.
Going back, actually, so much so that going back to the time of offer.
Right.
Okay. And knowing that a lot of money is going to be put down, that potentially at that point, because that buyer has that cash strength,
right,
that the appraisal is not going to mess
up the
deal. So in a multi-offer situation, which has been happening so much, those types of offers have more strength than a financed offer that's at 80%.
So keep in mind, though, that we won't know about a property inspection waiver until we actually identify the property, because that goes hand in hand with the underwriting findings that we get. But the knowledge of upfront saying that, yeah, we're looking at a 50% loan to value, we most likely will receive a property inspection waiver.
Right. And then even if you don't, mm-hmm. you know, in these cases, it's that the buyer has the strength that can bring the difference to the table.
Yeah, and one of the other things
is it does become an issue.
Sometimes with the offers coming in, say, at asking price or a little bit higher, and the appraisal doesn't come in quite where you want it, then it opens up the door. Okay, where's the negotiation? The buyer wants the house, the seller wants to sell the house, but they can't come to that, you know, that one number that they are looking for. Well, if they've put down 50%, and let's say we go to a 55% loan to value, well, there's not a big difference there. Everybody's still winning, so it helps in that transactional battle, so to speak.
Oh, I feel like this time we really dug in to the point. And those were the questions that I kept getting asked, so I'm glad that we talked about that. Now, the other question that I get a lot is, how come there's so much paperwork for buyers to do right now when it comes to the loan process?
Well, don't hate us. You know, we're all living to
giving you the opportunity to.
we're all living to guidelines and requirements, and like I kind of said earlier, understanding the complete picture of the borrower, and let's say that somebody's retired and they're taking a 401k distribution or IRA distribution, you know, is it enough, you know, to purchase the property? Well, if it's not, then what do we do? How do we go around that? Having that documentation in front of us allows us to analyze the complete puzzle and determine what it is that we can do to make a transaction go forward. Unfortunately, every question and answer with a document may raise another question. And it's stuff we don't know. So is there a lot of documentation? Yes, there is. Do we try to minimize that documentation? Yes, we do. Sometimes it's just not possible to do that. And also something that we found recently is that there are a lot of people buying that haven't gotten financing in the past 10, 15, 20, or 30 years.
So maybe some things have changed.
Some things have changed since the last time they've received financing, and it does require more documentation. You know, what I go by is trust but verify. You know, I trust what you're going to tell me, but I've got to verify that documentation to support. And, you know, the government requires that we show the ability to repay. And there's all these little facets that go into proving. And you can't do that just by taking the word.
Good point. Good point. That's probably one of my most frequently asked questions.
Mine too, believe it or not. Mine too.
And then finally, we talk so much about buyers when we talk about lending because the buyers are the ones who are getting the loan. But what do sellers need to know about lending in today's market?
Yeah, so the lenders are all on both sides. We're trying to get the deal done. And there are hiccups along the way. And we are working diligently to make every deal go through. And if for some reason that it's a quick request for a loan commitment of say 15 days, that's difficult to do. So we need a 21 to 30 day time frame. If the borrower has not come to us previously to get pre-approved.
Very good point.
You know, to make certain that the contract is written in such a way that it's beneficial to both parties. And that takes a little bit of time to do. Again, trust but verify. And then we've got to have all parties working together to get to that point. So sometimes there's a little concession here and there that we need to give on time. We don't like that, but sometimes it's outside of our control and we have to ask for that.
Sure. I know it makes me nervous too, you know, when you're waiting for things to come in.
And also,
especially with the entire industry right now is completely jammed and everybody's working full tilt.
Right. And also on the sellers, you know, they're also possible buyers. So what is their buying capacity after they sell?
Right. So you're going to sell this house. What are you moving on to and where do you stand for? Where's
the next step?
Yeah. Exactly. Well, I think we've dug into it a little bit deeper that time.
I think it's great. Yeah. It's awesome.
And I can't wait to find out how many questions I receive after today's interview. But thanks for joining us again.
Well, I really appreciate you having me and it's always a joy.
Thanks for joining us. And next week, I'll be back talking real estate stuff with another home service provider.